Welcome to the Unity Guys Expert Interview Series. My name is Clayton Stenson. I'll be your host today. This series is brought to you by Unity Guys Incorporated, where we help develop Unity within companies running on the entrepreneurial operating system. We do this through fractional integrator services and relationship coaching for the visionary and integrator. And the reason I started this interview series is that I've met some pretty amazing people in recent years, and the conversations that we've had have been valuable to me. So I thought I should share them with other people to add value to them as well. Today's guest is Mike Jones. Mike is an EOS implementer in Minnesota. Welcome, Mike.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Awesome. And today's topic is how to bring your core values to life. And I love this topic, as I find that sometimes core values become something that's on the website or in the marketing materials, but they don't have any power or practical impact. So tell me why, Mike, this is the topic that you chose to be interviewed about today.
Yeah, two parts. One is, I'm an EOS implementer, and so I'm in session rooms with clients every week. And the second session with clients in the EOS journey, they create their core values. And one of the things that makes EOS great is the way that we help teams come up with their core values, the process, and then the way we help them use them every day and how they operate their company and bring them to life. And we do that with figuring out how to get the right people in the right seats. That's a primary thing. But we also have core values shared frequently, and with EOS companies, they tend to get brought to life in really unique ways. And so then the other part is with my second company, Alchemy 365, which is an EOS company, we did that very effectively. And it was a really great way to tie in our core values, align them with our team, celebrate people who exemplify them. So I'm passionate about it, and I think about it every day with clients. So that's the reason.
Yeah, awesome. And what are some ways that you do it, that you bring it to life, that you talk about them regularly?
Yeah, so specifically in the companies that I've operated, my history is from the fitness industry as my entrepreneurial start. And so my first company was multiple CrossFit gyms, a 4-location CrossFit gym business, and we did not run EOS. And then my second company is called Alchemy 365, which is our own brand, and we implemented EOS with an implementer from day one. And so we went through the process that was already established of creating our core values, and that was almost 10 years ago. I don't run the company anymore. I'm on the board, so I'm not on the leadership team anymore. And so our core values have actually changed, but the way we bring them to life has remained the same. And so a couple of ways that we did it is, one, once we established them, one of our core values, which remains, is pursue your legend. And so Alchemy 365 is based on the book The Alchemist from Paulo Coelho, famous book. And in that book, it's about a guy pursuing his legend. And so that concept and term is from the book, and we used it as one of our core values. And it also became a tagline, which is not typical nor recommended to make your core values your tagline. In our case, it was conveniently an awesome tagline. And so you'll find Pursue Your Legend sprinkled throughout Alchemy 365 branding on the website. In some of the studios, on the wall, there'll be a giant Pursue Your Legend. It's kind of all over the place. And it's been used for almost 10 years. And so it is something that our employees and our members know they believe in. It resonates with them. And our teammates try to live it. And so that's one example. Mm-hmm. That thread carries throughout lots of different things, where each quarter we would have a state of the company meeting where we talk about our vision, traction, organizer, our strategic plan, share it with the entire company, share the quarterly plan, get everybody pumped up. And we would have nominations for what we call Legends Award, which is someone who exemplifies the core values. And so each quarter, teammates would nominate their other teammates, and they would call out with a story of how they exemplified one of our four core values. And then each quarter we'd tabulate, and we would have somebody read each core value, and then they would read a story that was submitted from one of our teammates about one of our teammates. And that was just a really great way to recognize people's hard work, create that collaborative culture. And then whoever got the most votes each quarter would win the Legend Award. And that has changed what the award was over time, from, you know, $100 when we were just starting out, where it would increase every quarter. And then at some point they started doing like a sabbatical award, things like that. So they change it up regularly. But the point is to have interesting creative ways to make it so that everyone is thinking about the core values on a regular basis, as opposed to, like you said, as opposed to most companies, in my opinion and experience, they may have gone through the core value process and established them, and that's generally where it stops, and they get placed somewhere and not really used. And so that's one way. And I have a couple other examples of just how we've brought them to life with my companies, and I've seen it done with other companies.
Yeah. It reminds me of my first time I was integrator. I'd worked in the company for 3 years. I didn't know about EOS. And then when I read Traction the first time, I'm reading the vision chapter and reading about core values. And I'm like, do we have core values? And I went on our website. And guess what? We did. And I was like, oh, I've been here 3 years. How come I didn't know that there was core values, right? And so then I did step into the integrator role and started to, you know, put a little more attention to that. And it was one cool thing we did is we put in one of the offices, we put all our offices were open. So we had a brick wall, and we got a graffiti artist to come in and write the core values on the wall. Like, that's obviously, you know, a small part of it, but it was kind of a cool thing we did to bring them into the forefront a little more. But
I love that.
What was the impact when you started doing that? Your quarter Legends Award.
The impact is a couple fold. One, the most important impact is the employees know the core values. That's the most important thing, is what do we have to do to make it so that our employees actually know our core values and actually use them? You know, because we could talk for a while, and we can if we want, about how to bring them to life in terms of how we hire, reward, and fire people, right? Which is really the hallmark of the core values to create culture. But the first step is, do the employees know it? So that's the biggest impact, is just by making a quarterly thing that everyone went through, and the teammates actually had to read the core values, think about who on their team exemplifies them, come up with a story and submit it. And then someone gets recognized, the story gets read again, that reinforcement, that ends up being kind of like that seven times that people need to hear something before they get it, or each quarter they get it, you know, somewhere up to seven times. And that's how it gets reinforced. If they know it and the core values have gone through the appropriate process so that they're established in a way that they are not aspirational, not accidental, and not pay to play, you know, real core values that really exemplify the organization's culture, and they're repeated regularly, that's how people can start using them on a daily basis.
I'm just curious, from a practical perspective, you talked about how day two of the EOS process is helping to create the core values. Could you give us a glimpse inside how you do it?
Yeah, absolutely. So when companies implement EOS with an implementer, they, on day one, they do what's called focus day, and they start using the foundational tools, the accountability chart, the rocks, the meeting pulse, the scorecard. And they go through, also go through hitting the ceiling and the five leadership abilities that are used throughout EOS to break through the ceiling. And then day two, They come back a month later and do a whole day session where we review those tools. And then we go into answering the 8 questions of the Vision Traction Organizer, the VTO. And the first question is, what are your core values? And so we spend 2 to 4 hours establishing core values. And so we go through the exercise of ideating and brainstorming the traits and attributes of the people on each leadership team's teams that exemplify who they think are the best employees they have, who are the best teammates. And then we go through a process of narrowing down, applying through a filter based on some of Pat Lencioni's work to define what great core values are, apply that filter, narrow down until they get down to basically words that are categorized into those 3 to 7 buckets. And ideally, we're closer to 3 than 7. And we get to the point where the teams can look at each other and nod and be like, yeah, this is who we are. Mm-hmm. And then they go away for another month, and one person gets assigned to write what's called the speech, which is organize what those core values are about. And then we come back and refine it again a month later. And so it's kind of an iterative process. And we use the filter from Pat Lencioni's work that has a 3-part elimination of options. And so the first one is accidental. So accidental core values are things that were traits that got you up to a certain point as an organization, but they're going to hold you back in the future. So that's maybe traits that were based on the founder's grit, initial experience, whatever got them there, but the team knows we can't keep doing that. So that's accidental. They got to go. They can't be core values. Aspirational is the second one. And aspirational are core values that we wish that we had or we aspire to have. And if they're not actually representative of who we are as a company, they'll fall apart. They won't resonate. They won't work. So those have to go away as well.
Yeah.
And then the third is pay to play. And that's just kind of standard values that every good company has, like honesty, integrity, hard work. And so we want to eliminate pay to play core values as well.
Mm-hmm. That are just assumed that obviously everybody's going to say that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's good. That'll probably be helpful to maybe to somebody who's self-implementing that's watching today. So thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. Self-implementers can read the Pat Lencioni article that I am not thinking of the name, but there's 1 of 2 articles that we can find and share on. It's make your values matter, I think is what it's called. Yeah. Or make your values count. And it literally walks you through the process for creating great core values. So yeah, it's a great exercise. The challenge for self-implementing companies or a company that doesn't run EOS and just wants to make up their own core values is typically what someone would do is like the owner would sit in a room for an hour and come up with them on his own and share them, but they'll never work. The team has to get together, spend 2 to 5 uninterrupted hours together, transition into a session of working on their business, and then go through an exercise to create it. And if they do, they'll come up with something great. But if they don't give it the time it deserves, it'll always just be kind of like mediocre core values.
Yeah. So I'm probably more of an integrator, right, than a visionary, although I do have a fairly high visionary tendency. And my visionary side of me is like 2 to 5 hours, right? Like why would I invest 2 to 5 hours in that, you know? So answer that question, because there might be somebody that's thinking that if they're listening to this or watching.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great point. Almost everything, if you hear like the EOS process, if you hear it, you'd be like, oh, that feels like too long. I feel like we can do it faster. The reality after doing it, you know, if you do it enough to do it right, the magic is in getting together as your leadership team, removing distractions, and spending time working on your business, which is so rarely done because you don't have time because you're sitting in many seats. So the magic is in taking the time and taking the extra time to do it. And so the reason I say that is the actual core value part during a facilitator-led exercise with an EOS implementer is going to be 2 to 3 hours within an 8-hour day. So we spend an hour checking in, transitioning, getting integrated into the space together, and then we're working on it. So that's why I say, if you want to do it right with your team, you need to give yourself extra time, because you need to have some time to decompress and break the ice and get so you're actually talking about real stuff.
Yeah. And I'd like to answer my own question as well, because I think a lot of visionaries, it's like they got where they are through, like you kind of mentioned earlier, grit, pushing through, to be honest, cutting corners, breaking rules, doing all of these things that are great for starting a company. But if you want buy-in and you want engagement and you want to surround yourself with a team, those things don't work, right?
Absolutely.
Like, you still need those things in certain contexts and situations. But if you really want people's, I put it this way, you can have their body or you can have their heart, right? And to get their heart, you have to slow down, right? And you have
Absolutely.
To be intentional, and you have to, do these things. You have to have core values, and not just core values you came up with, but core values that you came up with together, and a plan that you came up together, and a process that you built together. And that takes more time, but you'll go further, faster in the long run. But it is
absolutely.
Would you agree with that?
I couldn't agree more. I've experienced it myself, building my own companies multiple times from 0 to 100 employees. And there is just this time where you may not notice it unless you take some time to step back, but it might look like starting to get stuck, feeling like you don't have your arms around the business anymore, feeling like you're losing control, feeling like you're not able to get people to do what you want to do. And that's the phase of going from doing everything yourself to having a leadership team that's cohesive, doing everything for the business. And that transition is so hard that most companies never make it. Most companies fail. Mm-hmm. So in order to do it, you have to do exactly what you said, which is be open and vulnerable enough to discard and recognize the things that won't serve you going forward, and bring together and build those new values that have been established over time that represent the actual team. And that's it can be a very difficult process, but it is important. And then just quickly thinking back about doing it myself, I would absolutely recommend, if you're starting right now with one person on your journey with a company, set your core values and use them on day one to hire, reward, fire people. But as you start bringing on a team, at some point, please be open to discarding them and coming up with new ones as a team. And you'll find if you do it right, you will find that they're really representative of who the team is and wants to be. Mm-hmm. And that's where you'll be able to grow.
Yeah, and I would say, and I've never thought this before, but it just kind of came to me as we were talking here. The core values is one of the things, like as you're letting go of control as a visionary, core values is one of the things that kind of allows you to still have some control. Do you know what I mean? Like controlling it's a different kind of control, right? Like you're building a culture, you're building this framework of how we do things and who we are, right? And so if you're letting go, having core values helps you to still have some level of control. Does that make sense? It's kind of a weird way that I'm saying it, but
absolutely. Yeah, it's a dichotomy, or it's a counterintuitive thing where just growing a company, you have to give up more and more control over time. And the way to do that in a way that moves everything in the way you want is having a clear vision, having clear values, having a clear focus, knowing truly who you are as an organization. And so that everyone, when they're operating, they have this constant filter of knowing what the values of the organization they're in, and they have to be aligned with those values. It makes their decision-making easier. And so that's why core values are so important. They make it so that people can make better decisions faster.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good. That's good. So what are some other practical ways that core values are mixed into the EOS journey? I guess I'll put it that way.
So I already mentioned my history with how we brought them to life in our quarterlies with awards and things like that. So that's one way to make it so that your team knows them. The other one that comes to mind, the primary means, I would say, is in your hiring, evaluation, and firing process. And so what I mean by that is, if you have real core values that the company, that truly represents the company, you can structure your interview questions and job description when you're hiring people in a way that when you interview them, if you gave them a core value that was really exemplified who you are, that's a real core value, you can tell them stories and ask questions in a way that will repel the wrong people. It will make the wrong people not want to work for you. And it's hard to explain how that works unless you actually do it. And you're nodding your head because I know you've done it before. Yeah. And I believe you probably are like, yeah, this actually works. It really does. And so that's the biggest thing, where you structure your hiring, job description, interview questions so that you are asking them questions and sharing core value stories in a way that makes the right people are like, oh yeah, I want to be here. And the wrong people are like, and they don't interview well and they end up not taking the job. And that's what you want. That carries through the evaluation. So when you do your quarterly evaluations or annual, whatever you do, you measure people against your core values. So that's culture fit. And that's really important because that's not necessarily job performance. Job performance is, are they meeting the requirements of the job? But core values is often different. So being able to evaluate people on core values is a way to remove or correct people who are not exemplifying the culture that you want to build. And then when you get to ultimately firing someone, being able to consistently know if someone is not does not live your core values is a way to move people out of your organization. And so that's probably the biggest day-to-day. How do you build culture? How do you use them within an organization? And again, I'm obviously a lover of EOS. There are many systems and there are many that are good. That would be a thing that I would say as a requirement for anyone thinking about systems would be, how do they use core values? Is it used in a way that actually brings them to life? We know that if you use EOS frameworks, it does. And it's something that actually can be used every day.
Yeah. And I think you talked about how people will self-select in the interview process, which I experienced too, but do you find that people self-select when you first roll out core values as well? Like you start really clarifying the vision and who you are as a company. Do you find that people start to self-select and like resign and leave in those situations?
Absolutely. Yeah. That's another power of a really strong culture is the people who are not a core value fit. Some of them, of course, will stick around forever and you have to fire them, which is really unfortunate and nobody likes doing that. It sucks. But really, honestly, what really happens, and has happened in my experience of operating companies for over 10 years, is a lot of times as you get more and more clear on what your core values are, people that aren't a fit, they self-select out and they will leave the company. And that's great for everybody because it is hard to fire people and not desirable. In fact, when you implement EOS, when you establish your core values, you do a test. Once you've established them, you rate the leadership team, and generally the leadership team, if everyone believes it's the right people in the right seat, is going to be pluses or yes on everything. But then you'll rate the best employee and then rate the employee that everyone thinks is the least good fit for core values. And if the core values are good, and well established, there'll be a person that's a no, 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 no. And you don't have to fire them immediately, but you have to start having conversations. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it can happen pretty quickly. And it's very effective.
Mm-hmm. If anyone wants to know about that, it's called the People Analyzer. It's a great tool. I'm actually doing a, with one of my clients tomorrow, we're doing a people analyzer session where we're gonna do that, use that tool on our team. It's great. It's a great tool because it cuts through the you know, opinions and stuff, and sometimes, you know, biases or, you know, emotional connection with people. And sometimes you do the people analyzer on someone and you're like, wow, why didn't I see this right before? This is a major issue and we need to do something about it. And I'm probably a little more biased around coaching, you know, and supporting and trying to give everybody the benefit of the doubt and, you know, challenge them that we probably didn't, maybe we didn't do a good job of communicating what we wanted. So we're going to, you know, give them an opportunity to challenge, which also another kind of another tool is the 3-strike rule, right? Like really challenging somebody, giving them, you know, 90 days to turn things around and adjust. And often people self-select in that situation too.
Yep, which is good. Absolutely.
But the reality is someone who's not a core values fit, and GW see their role, like the people analyzer talks about, they're probably toxic, right?
Very likely.
And so they're holding you back. So it's a great tool. Anything else that you want to add around core values that you think would be helpful, that would add value?
I think I like to lean into the core of what core values are for, which is to truly define the culture of your organization. So I would say it's two parts would be that practical everyday use, like I just talked about in terms of hiring, evaluating, firing. But then the other part would be creative ways to make it come to life. And so that's doesn't have to just be during the quarterly. By all means, I think it's kind of almost standard to have an interesting way to revisit your core values during your quarterly all hands meeting. But just like you said, spray paint the wall with your core values, have as part of your branding internally, sometimes even externally, it's nothing wrong sharing your core values with clients and customers. Constantly find ways to bring it to life. A great way to think, and this is with actually a client last week during vision building day one, they were talking about the brand seat and they made the realization, they're like, our core values establish our brand. So that's a higher level function. And I was like, yes, your core values heavily dictate what your overall company's brand is. So use that every day. And so that's where how I think is like core values are at the highest level of your organization. They define your culture. They also define your brand. So they should be always thought of when you're making big decisions within the company.
And when you put it that way, that it defines your brand, it defines your culture, 2 to 5 hours is worth it.
Yeah. When you put it that way, that's actually a short period of time to establish them. Great. Yeah. Great point.
Those are two pretty big things, right?
Yeah.
Two pretty big items. There was something else that I was going to say. Oh, another example, my current fractional client, they do a character of the month. They called it, they haven't done it since I've been there, but we're going to get that going again. And what they do is they identify someone who's doing great things and, you know, is a good core values fit and, you know, and they do a picture, like a caricature of them, like a sketch, right? And they add in like something that's interesting about them. Like one of the guys is drumming cause he's a drummer, right? So it's like a picture of him, a cartoon picture of him drumming and, you know, and his name and it's great. I love it. Right. It's an interesting way to do it. Like you're kind of like you're talking about. So,
and with AI now, they can probably make an awesome picture in like 10 seconds now too.
Oh yeah. For that kind of thing. Didn't know that.
I'm sure.
Yeah. That's awesome. Awesome. Well, this has been great. I think this is a kind of an undervalued thing, often. And I like that you mentioned even as a solopreneur, you know, one person, you know, doing it as well. And I've done that as well, years ago. And it helps me to really get clear about partially about who I want to work with or for, right? It's like sometimes, you know, well, every time when I'm meeting with a potential client, I'm asking questions just like you would hiring, right, to determine if we're a values match. Because particularly visionary integrator, you better have a values match, right? Because it's it's not going to work. In my opinion, the integrator needs to be pretty strong, you know, and push back against the visionary. And if you don't have a values match, that's not going to go. That's not
Yeah, good. Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. Yeah. For solos, solopreneurs, I'm a solopreneur right now as an EOS implementer. And so, yeah, I use the EOS corporate core values as my own. And I have two that are my own as well. And I use them and I share them with vendors. I share them with my assistant. So, yeah, they're important when you're with one, when you're a company of one as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome, Mike. So we're just wrapping up here. So if someone wants to learn more about you and what you do, and how should they get in touch with you?
Yeah, so I'm at mike.jones@eosworldwide.com is my email. I'm also very active on LinkedIn, Mike Jones, EOS implementer. And those would be the two primary ways.
Yeah, and I'd encourage you to follow Mike on LinkedIn. He's got great content.
Thank you.
Awesome. And if today's interview added value to you, please subscribe to this channel for future interviews with experts in the world of business. And thank you again, Mike. It's been fun.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.